Good morning. How's the Memorial Day weekend going? Got any fun plans going on? Well, you know, it's really been on my mind this morning that I just never get tired of singing for Jesus. And I can tell you that I've searched far and wide for meaning in life from external sources, and I've really just come to the conclusion that there is nothing worthy of our time and our worship and our praise than Jesus Christ. Do you agree with me this morning? Would you stand up and we'll get to singing here. For you.
Good morning. Aren't we thankful for God's promises? We were talking about it this morning in our kids' Sunday school class about, you know, God called Elijah to a very hard thing. He called him to go to a king and tell him it's not going to rain here. And that's a hard thing to do sometimes, go and deliver a word that God wants you to. But God protected Elijah, and he got to spend a little time living by a brook and getting fed by the birds. So, of course, there's a little debate. Would we rather get fed by ravens or by monkeys? So that was kind of a bit of discussion this morning. But we had a good time, and right after announcements, we'll head on back over to Kids Church. Miss Danielle and Jessica are in South Carolina today, and then they're going to meet us at camp tomorrow. We are student camp is tomorrow. We're going to leave here about 9 o'clock tomorrow morning and head over to Lookout Mountain up there on the top of Georgia, where we're going to have a great time, get no sleep, and eat terrible food. Amen. So we are looking forward to it, and it's going to be a great time. But do please keep us in prayer. Keep me in prayer, and it's going to be great. And we're certainly looking forward to it. I got a bunch of students looking forward to go. So just an update, we were planning on doing a kids workers meeting tonight, and those that are going to be helping with Vacation Bible School, we're postponing that a week just to allow some folks time to get back in the area. And we know there are some Memorial Day plans tonight, so we're going to push that back 1 week. And so I'm passing out leader's guides, so if anybody needs one of the leader's guides that I missed, let me know, and you can take a look at that this week. And then we will meet next week, and we'll knock that out. So VBS registration is open. We've got print guides. We've also got them up on the church website, which is generally the easiest way to register and the best way for me because it comes straight to my email. So if you got anybody that wants to register, send them to the church website, and they can get registered online, mounthopebaptistal.com, and we'll get that knocked out. And then next Sunday, Brianna's got a bridal shower, so it's coming up fast. I know she's looking forward to it, so he won't be Mr. Brianna anymore. Nuh-uh, it'll have to go the other way around now, so she'll be Ms. Cole. So that'll be next Sunday, 1:30 to 3:30. She's registered at Walmart, Hobby Lobby, and that other retail establishment that shall not be named. So... So if you need something but not a bathing suit, you can go and get something from that place over there too. So let me say a word of prayer, and then our group's going to head back over to Kids Church, which is temporarily in the Life Center as we're rebuilding the kids' building for Vacation Bible School. And we're doing a great study on going through the Gospels right now. And we're wrapping up in the book of Matthew this week and then moving into Luke next week. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, we're so thankful this morning that we can come to you. God, that we can trust you, and knowing that nothing compares to the promises that we have in you. And we know that all of your promises are yes and amen. God, you love us, you take care of us, you do send us into hard places sometimes, but you have prepared that way and you prepared the things for us to do. God, I know that we can rely on your promise that we'll be with you for all of eternity. You wanted us to be with you, and to put that down payment on that promise, you even gave us your Holy Spirit to dwell with us now. God, I pray that in that spirit and that truth this morning, that we would worship you, knowing we can trust all your promises. We thank you for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. And I want to say thank you to Billy for everything he does for our youth. And I just remember going to youth camp, and those were some of the first times that I felt that fire in my heart be lit for Jesus. And it's not an exaggeration to say that I might not be a Christian today if it weren't for those experiences. So thank you, Brother Billy. Would you all stand up and keep singing with me?
Praise the mountain fixed upon it.
Well, from what I hear, this next song used to be popular here at Mount Hope Baptist Church, especially in the youth group back in like the late 80s, early 90s. Maybe some of you remember that. I don't, because I wasn't even alive. But if you remember this song, go ahead and sing it out loud, okay? I will run You, God, for what you've done for us, for laying down your life, God, and that's why we say how great you are, because you did what none of us could do, God, and you took away the sins that are bearing us down, God, and you made us free. God, I just pray a blessing over each and every person here, that they would feel that weight lifted off their shoulders every single day. God, we just thank you so much for your son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see you in the Lord's house this morning. I hope everybody's okay. I hope you had a great time in Sunday school. If you're not in Sunday school, we ask that you come and join us at 9:30. We've got lots of places that we can park you. As many of you know, this is Memorial Day weekend. A lot of confusion about what Memorial Day weekend is. It's not a day to celebrate our veterans. We have Veterans Day, and if truth be known, we ought to be celebrating them every day. Every time you see a man or a woman in uniform or wearing a hat, go up to them and thank them for their service. This weekend is not just a day off. It's not just a long weekend. It's a day that we celebrate the sacrifices that were made for us, those that gave their lives in the line of service. This is the only time of year that we do that. For some of us, it's a very painful weekend to be able to realize what it means to be a Gold Star family member. So this morning, I'm going to ask you, those of you that have lost a life, a family member, give them up in the line of service. Gold Star families, I'm going to ask you to stand with me this morning. I'm going to ask you to go to the Lord in prayer with me again this morning. Father God, we thank you so much for being able to stand before you this morning, Lord. Father, it's with a heavy heart, Lord, that we remember those that gave their lives for us. Father, just like Jesus did on the cross. Father, we know where the red and the flag comes from and where the white and the flag comes from and what the stars mean. Father, we just thank you for the precious memories of those that have gone on before us, Lord. God, we hate war. God, we hate the fact that we have to take up arms against each other. God, I pray for a time when the lion will lay down with the lamb. Father, when we will have peace sitting at your feet around the awesome throne that is. God, be with us this morning, Lord, as we break your bread, Lord. Bring us peace. God, help us to be able to celebrate you. Father, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much. Got a few announcements I want to make this morning before we get started. One of them is, we're going to take a little bit of a needed vacation for our Wednesday night children's and youth workers. We're going to hold off until July the 11th when we'll be meeting back again. And in that time, I got a few things I want you to be praying about. Number one is, we need some big brothers for some of the young men that we have coming on Wednesday night. Now, what does that look like? That looks like just sitting with these young men and talking with these young men and interacting with these young men and showing them how a godly man lives. We're not asking you to teach. We're not asking you to fill in. We're just asking you to sit with these young men and just invest in their lives. And we also need some big sisters that would sit down with some of these young ladies and invest in their lives and show them what godly women look like. And number two, we need some godly couples that will be willing to sit in these classes just as a man and a wife, and let them see what a godly couple looks like. Not asking you to teach, not asking you to lead in prayer, not asking you to do anything other than let them see what a godly home looks like. And then another thing I want to call to your attention this morning is, we're thankful to have Brother Brian and Ms. Sheena back in the sound room. We're convinced that, number one, Brother Brian probably just ate some bad Mexican and it just didn't agree with him. And number two, he needed a Monday off work. So what better way, you know, than to break out in a sweat and elevate your heart rate, you know, and run your blood pressure through the roof. I mean, it works for us, right, guys? We are glad to have you back, brother. You're an answered prayer. And then lastly, we had a flyer that was put over in our food pantry, over in our food bank. And I've got permission to brag on this, and I'm not going to get beat for doing it. And I know we don't do this for pats on the back, and we don't do this for accolades. But this is from the agency director over the North Alabama Food Bank, to my understanding. And it says, I am quite pleased to report that you had a rare, flawless site survey. I don't get to write this very often, so congratulations. There were no out of compliance is found in our food bank, our food pantry. So, you know, hats off to those that put that on and make that happen. We can brag about that. We really, really have a broad-reaching ministry with that, and we're so thankful for that. Today we're going to continue looking at women of faith. And today the title of the lesson will be The Riches of Poverty. And I'm going to ask you to go ahead and turn with me to Mark chapter 12. If you'll notice this month, we've looked at four different ladies, and only one of those four ladies actually had a name. And I say that to say that you don't have to have a visible presence to make an awesome impact in somebody's life. So many times, folks, we feel like we're nameless, we feel like we're faceless, we feel like we're somebody's this, we feel like we're somebody's that, and since I don't have an identity of myself, I don't have any impact. And that's just not true. There are so many times that people make an impact on your life. Now, I was sharing with Brother Johnny before church started this morning, I met a friend this week, and he was my age, and we have a lot of things in common. And we stood in my yard for 15 minutes describing a guy. We knew everything about him but his name. We never could remember that guy's name. You know, it's oh so-and-so's son, oh such-and-such's brother, oh flathead down the road. You know, we all got a name for somebody, but we cannot remember their name. That does not make them any less important in our life. That just means that maybe me and my new friend weren't kind to ourselves, so therefore we can't remember. We've hit our head one too many times. But ladies, I want you to understand that you don't have to be named to be very important in somebody's life. You have a purpose. You have a plan. And it might be that, yeah, you're somebody's mama, or yeah, you're somebody's wife, or yeah, you're somebody's teacher or somebody's neighbor, and that's how you're known. Don't let that degrade who you are in your mind, because you are very important in God's eyes. Today we're going to look at the widow and her two mites. And this story is recounted for us in two different versions in the gospel. And I want us to read both of them this morning, because in neither one of these versions is this lady named. So she will be the nameless hero for us today. Starting in Mark chapter 12, and then we'll flip over to Luke 21. Mark chapter 12, starting in verse 41. I appreciate your prayers this morning. I'm recovering from a migraine, so if I get a little tongue-tied and I may skip a word, please just bear with me. And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast in much. So just set the scene there. Jesus is kicked up against the wall. I don't know if he's sitting or standing. He may be seated. He may be sitting crisscross applesauce. We don't know. But he can see the offering plate, the offering bucket, the offering horn. He can see that. And he's watching. And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which make a farthing. And he called unto him his disciples and said unto them, verily I say unto you that this poor widow hath cast in more than all they that have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living. Then if you'll turn with me to Luke chapter 21, you can take your ribbon and slide it there in the book of Mark. Luke chapter 21 starts out with this same story. In my Bible is titled "The Widow's Sacrificial Offering." It says, and he looked up and saw the rich men casting their gifts into the treasury, and he saw also a certain poor widow casting in thither two mites. And he said, of a truth I say unto you, that this poor widow has cast in more than they all. For all these have of their abundance cast in unto the offerings of God. But she of her penury hath cast in all the living that she had. The riches of poverty. And we'll explain that at the end. That'll be our fourth point for those over there keeping notes this morning. A couple of things we can glean from this story. Number one, Jesus is very observant. Jesus is very observant. Now, when you go shopping, if you're like me and you get drugged there, do you like to sit and watch the people as they walk by? There have been times when I've set my daughters down while the other one and mom or whatever's in there, and I may ask them some questions. What do you think about this person? It's been a while since we've done that. But what do you think about this person? What do you know about this person? Or maybe we drive by somebody and we'll say, observe this person. What do you know about this person just from looking at them? Now, some of us may draw one conclusion. Some of us may draw another conclusion. But what we are doing is looking at the outward appearance of whomever it is we're looking at, right? We may notice that they have a limp, or we may notice that they're humped over, that they're on a walker, that they're dragging somebody behind them, or they got that look of, Lord, just kill me now. I can't take no more of this place. But we look on the outside where Jesus, being very observant, looks on the inside, right? He looks past the outward appearance of men. Jesus is observing the treasury. The treasury, the whatever the receptacle was, we'll get to that in a moment, where money or offerings are brought in and they're giving, and it has a purpose, the same as our offering plates do. The treasury was used for operations in the temple. I mean, it's the same thing as today for the operations of the church. I mean, toilet paper does not magically appear. Tissues do not magically appear. Lights don't come on just because it's the right thing to do. Salaries don't get paid. I mean, it's for the operations of the facility. But most importantly, the treasury was used to help others. Now let that sink in for a minute. Not only does the giving, the tithes and the offerings go to the upkeep, it's also to help other people. Like the food pantry that I just mentioned. You would be surprised how many families come through this food pantry, and this little bit of food that we're able to give them is a great relief to them. When we run out of food, it's very heartbreaking to tell people all we've got left is beans and a roll of paper towels. We'd be happy to give you that. We're going to give you that anyway, but that's all we got left. Then we always get something in the meat line that most of us may not want to eat, and we'll ask some folks, hey, we've got some of this, and it's not a real popular thing. Would you like to have it? And some people will take anything they can get. You think about helping people. Malachi chapter 3 says this, bring you all the tithes in the storehouse that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sake, and he shall not destroy the fruits of the ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, saith the Lord of hosts. Malachi 3, 10, 11, and 12. God will call you blessed if you will give. Now go back to where Jesus is sitting there, and he's observing the treasury. He sees what people give in, not from their hand, but from their heart. He's commenting on how people give. Some give a lot, some give a little. Now, if you had $1 million and you dropped $100 in the treasury, that would seem like a lot of money to me, because $100 is $100. But now, to a millionaire, that's a drop in the bucket. But if all you had was $100 and you dropped $100 in there, that means a whole lot more, does it not? Because you're giving of all that you have versus what little you're giving of the much that you possess. Some gave lots, some gave little, but one gave all. Now, how many people in our times give a little out of their abundance or give an abundance out of their poverty? How much do we give? Not just in the offering plate, but as a true offering to all those who are in need. You see, Jesus knew the thoughts and the intents of the hearts of the people that walked by. He was not so much concerned about what was in their hand as they dropped, as it was the heart that protruded the hand out. Psalms 139:1 says, O Lord, you've searched me and known me. God knows everything we do, and we honestly have the nerve to think that Jesus does not know. I'll slide this in there and make like it's a real big deal when it's really not. I can fool some of the people some of the time, or all of the people all the time, but God can be fooled none of the time. Let's say Jesus was watching us, which He is. What would He see us do in our lives? How many times have we said this in Sunday school class? You're not judged by sitting in Sunday school. You're not judged by sitting in church. You're judged by your language at the store and your driving habits on the highway and how you cheat people on the job. That is how you're judged. And no, we're not the judge and the jury, but we're fruit inspectors, right? Because a tree is known by the fruit it bears. What does Jesus see when He looks at us? Are we on our first date best behavior? Are we having a bad day? You better get out of my way. Or are we somewhere in between? Jesus is watching us and He is very observant. And you know what? It's not just Jesus who's really observant. It's the people in our lives that are really observant too. Amen? Or oh me. Number two, people can be very vain. I mean, let's face it, we can just be vain. Even Solomon said it's all vanities, vanities of vanities. You want all this stuff and all it does is just to make you look fancy. I mean, it's got a look to it. I mean, you spend a lot of money for a pair of blue jeans that look like they've been wore out. My daddy says I wouldn't wear them things in the outhouse because I had to wear them like that when I was kids. Yet we want it to look like we've really worked for something when we have not. Vain. In Matthew chapter 6, the Bible says this, verses 1 through 4, take heed that do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Likewise, you have no reward of your Father in heaven. Therefore, when you do thy alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when you do alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand does, that thy alms may be in secret, and thy Father which sees in secret shall reward you openly. Now, when it talks about sounding the trumpet, now I've had this explained to me before, and I've read about this, and there's two schools of thought on there. One of them is they're calling everybody's attention. They're saying, everybody look, I'm about to drop something in here, as if they're sounding it for everybody to hear and everybody to know. I'm going down there and I'm going to give my offering, and oh boy, is it a big one, and padow, there it is, ka-ching, ka-chow, whatever it is you want to say. The other thought is that there was a funnel, like a horn, that would funnel everything down into this bucket. It's like one of those things that you see sometimes in the convenience stores and whatever. You drop the coin in there and it rolls around and rolls and rolls, and they've come up with a water slide now for some of you that ain't got the sense you's born with. You can go round and round like a toilet and get flushed down the hole down in there. That's the principle of this horn. So you can imagine if you dropped a little in there, it would go tinkle, 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 tinkle. Tsh. And if you dropped a lot in there, it would make an awful racket, would it not? So let's just say you's going to drop a dollar bill in there. Dollar bill don't make a lot of sound, does it? Four quarters will make four tinkles. But you drop 100 pennies in there, if you didn't see it, if all you did was heard it, which one would you think gave the most? The man with the 100 pennies or the woman with the $1? Same amount. They'd probably be more happy, those that had to count the money, if you dropped a dollar in there than if you dropped 100 pennies in there. But everybody that just heard it and didn't see it would think, oh my goodness, this person has gave a war pension into here. Adding more to make more sound is vanity. Amen? Putting on more to make look more is vanity. Imagine just seemingly like you've given all this money where God, being very observant, is seeing in you and you're not getting that blessing. Because you gave your alms, as we just read, before men. Therefore, you've got your reward. That arm extended and that pat on the back is all you're going to feel from what you just did. Really putting on a show. Let me ask you this. Are we more satisfied with big spenders than we are with people that give from their poverty? I don't want to know who gives what. I can't deal with that. I've got enough that I have to worry about already. I don't want to know. Everybody picks on me when we don't get rain. You're not turning in my tithe. We're paying you, you're not turning. I don't know what you are. I don't have a clue. I don't want to know. The reason I don't want to know is because the flesh will say, well, this person gave a lot of money and this person didn't give much money. But the engineer side of me kicks in and says, yeah, it was a lot of money, but it's only 3%. They gave 75%. Money-wise, this may be a lot less than this is, but heart-wise, they're giving trust in God where they're just looking for a tax write-off. Are we really putting on a show? Are we really trying to please man rather than please God? Are we really that vain? You know when it says don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing? I don't need to know what you're giving. You don't need to know what I'm giving. If you can sleep with it, that's fine. A lot of times the argument comes up, well, when you do your tithe, when you do your 10%, is that before taxes or after taxes? Is that before all my insurance and everything's took out and my 401k and my fill in the blank and my Christmas club and whatever? Or is it after all that's been took out of it? We just take the big number and lop a zero off and round it. It's a whole lot easier that way. Do you want to be blessed on the net or the gross? And that's just a tithe. That's not an offering. An offering is above and beyond. But yet, are we so vain? We don't see Jesus being observant of us. Number three, Jesus honors the humble. What was it that caught the attention of Jesus for this teachable moment? You ever have those teachable moments? You find yourself in the ditch and you're upside down and somebody comes and you're fine, but they look at you and they want to ask you, what did we learn from this? Okay, you've cut yourself. Now, what did we learn from this? Okay, now you're in this situation. Did you learn anything? Jesus is asking us something because it caught His attention. Knowing He's very observant, knowing how people tend to look and act when a crowd is watching Him, it was the offering of the widow that set all this in motion. You see, a mite, I got some of this off the Samford University website, it says it's known as a lepton, which was a Jewish coin and the smallest coin used in the New Testament. At the time of the writing, it was worth about 1/64th of a denarius, and the denarius, being a Roman coin, was about a day's wage for a common worker. So you figure out whatever you'd make in a day and divide it by 64, and that's a mite, give or take. And you know, a lot of people argue, well, it's this, it's that, it's an eighth of a penny, it's 8 pennies, it's what? Does it really matter how much it was? You see, we get hung up on numbers. I can't give but $10, and $10 ain't very much. If I could give $20, it'd be a whole lot better. Or if I could give $100, man, that'd just be awesome. I mean, we get hung up on those numbers, but does it really matter? Because James 4:6 says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Go back to thinking about that treasury being used for those people in need. Who would have a greater need than the widow who just gave? Widow, no husband, no rights, no home, no nothing. If anybody needed a squirrel away for a rainy day, it was her, right? But what did she do with all that she had? Mark 12:44 and Luke 21:4 both say the same thing. They both say, she cast in all the living that she had. Who cares if it was a 64th of a day's wage or 6 months worth of salary? It was all of it. It wouldn't. Some of us have a habit in the side of our wallet over here. We got a little something, something just in case. Because there's every now and then the time when the debit card ain't going to work and the credit card didn't get paid and something other else and we can't use that one because that's a company card. You don't want to have to answer that one. So we got to have a little something, something over the side. So we'll give everything, but we keep that little something, something over the side. She didn't even have a something, something. She gave every bit of it because she was humble. When's the last time you gave all you had? Let's say they're taken up for something. Somebody's sick. Somebody's got cancer. Somebody's got bills to pay. And you look in your wallet and you got how much? Well, I need this for me and then I'm going to buy and this, so I'll give. How long has it been since you just said, here, take it all? It's God's anyways. 100% of anything is all of it. Whether it's this big or this big. How long has it been since you gave it all? You see, it takes humility to rely on God. Humility is the quality or condition of being humble, a modest opinion or an estimate of one's own importance. Humble means not proud or arrogant, modest, courteously respectful. In a nutshell, it's putting others before you, considering other needs first. How else can you give all you have unless you think someone else is more important than you? How many of you seen the little bracelets that says, I am second? How many of you have one of those, I am second? Somebody comes before me. Lastly, number four, the riches of poverty. Jesus is very observant. Vanity walks among us, and Jesus honors the humble. What are the riches of poverty? What are we the most stingy with? I mean, most stingy. I've got a good friend, and he's got a guitar. And there's about four or five of us that's trying to get higher up the inheritance list so we can be the one that gets that guitar. I mean, and he's pretty proud of it, and he don't want it to get tore up, and he sure don't want us jerking back and forth on it. He'll let you look at it, but you can't put it in your car because you may take it home. You may have something like that. You may have something that Grandma and Grandpa gave you, and it's going to stay with you until they pry it out of your cold, dead hands. What is it that you're most stingy with? The thing that you hold back for yourself, and not even God gets any of it. This is mine. This God, you can have all this other, but this right here is mine. I'm not going to let anybody have it. I'm not going to let anybody risk losing it, soiling it, breaking it. God, this is mine. If you think about it, time is one thing that we're very stingy with, aren't we? I want you to go back to Jesus sitting beside the treasury and watching this as people walk by and as they give of their offerings. What would they do with their time? Jesus is very observant, folks. He knows where we're vain and He knows where we're humble and He knows how important our time is. Man, we've been running like chickens with our heads cut off this whole month, seems like. I mean, and it ain't let up yet. Yesterday, this whole weekend, I've mowed my yard in like two or three different shifts just to get through it. Mow a while, shower, mow a while, shower. I mean, you're just wearing out the water heater. Time is something we are so guarded with, folks. But how much of it do we have left? If God were to ask you for half of your remaining life, would you give it to Him? What if God asked you for all of it? How much time do we have versus how much time do we give God? You know, Satan has given us all these things to do, folks. What if we were to use an opportunity meeting a new friend standing in our driveway to share Jesus Christ? What if we were to use the activities that come into our daily life to share Jesus Christ? What if we were to live a lifestyle of visitation where we had our eyes open and our ears open and we're looking for the needs and the opportunities all around us and we were trying our best to meet those and we didn't have to give any more of our time? We just used what we've already got. What about our talents? You know, some of us are real stingy with our talents. Man, I can fix anything these hands can tear apart, but I only fix mine. I don't fix nobody else's. Man, I can do things that would just boggle your mind, but I only do it for me. I don't do it for anybody else. Man, I can sing like the birds, but you ain't gonna catch me singing in front of y'all. Man, I can play anything I put my hands on, but I ain't going to do it in front of y'all. Man, I can teach a signboard to change directions right on the spot, but I'm not going to teach for God. How many talents do we have, folks, that are not being used for God's glory? Let's say Jesus is sitting there watching us walk by, and He knows the talents that we have, and He knows that we're not using them because maybe we're vain. How many talents do we give to God? What about our treasures? Time is very precious. Talents, man, we could use them, but we're a little bit nervous about that. I'm raising my hand up. I'm there with you. What about treasures that we hold on to? Not going to let anybody have it because it's mine. I need this for me. You know, that widow, if anybody had a right to be pulling out of that treasury, it was her. But what did she do? She put in a treasury. And I stand over here in the food pantry line as the widows come through, as they pop the trunk on their car or open up the back door, and we put that food in there. And I see those little widow hands as they hold up some money for Jennifer to take and put in the food pantry. They're not just taking, they're also giving. And the prayer is, take this, whatever it is, God, and multiply it. Not just for this precious little lady, not just to put in her back seat in her trunk, but for everybody that's in line behind them. Everybody that's already left, Lord, grow this so we can reach more people. How much of your treasures are you giving to God? A little bit? Has it become habit? Has it become one of those things where you just do it and you don't ever give it a second thought? Have we ever give God 100% of anything? It's so simple, folks, just to surrender. But we have to have the will and the initiative to do it. I'm going to ask you to bow with me this morning. Just simple, just short. Everybody can run out the door and get on down the road to whatever else they got to do. Going about the holiday. Jesus is very observant in your life, as well as mine, and all of us. We can't get in a dark room and turn the light off and hide from God. He knows. The thing we have to ask ourselves this morning is, have we let vanity get in the way of serving God? It's beneath me to do that. It's just not rightly my thing. I'm just sitting here and I'm soaking it all up and I'm souring as I go. It's not my time. Let me pray about it. Jesus is very observant. He saw this widow give everything she had. What little she had, she knew was God. She gave it to Him. We may be one of those that's got a lot, and we give a little, and we think we've done our job. We'd rather stroke a check and give somebody money than we had give them our time. And that may be the thing we're holding on to this morning we need to let go of, is our time. God gave us this time. We don't know how much we got left. Are we ready to face Him today knowing what we've done with our time? Maybe God has blessed us with some talents and we're not using them for His glory. Singing, playing, teaching, sitting beside a young man or a young woman in Wednesday night class. Sitting in there with your spouse and showing what a godly family looks like. Stopping when you see somebody struggling with their lawnmower in the yard. Sharing Jesus as you stand in line at the grocery store. What about our treasures? How long has it been since you let God have control of your finances, your possessions, your play pretties? If we want to see true riches in Jesus Christ, we've got to realize that in poverty, we're going to be humble. When we let go of everything and say, God, it's yours, then we have nothing. That's the definition of poverty. When we have nothing, God can bless us. But when we hold on to it, it's another God with a small g. And the one true God is a very jealous God. And don't be surprised if He doesn't move those things out of the way so we can see clearly. Father, my prayer as You spoke to us this morning. God, I want to thank You for this lesson for me, the widow's two mites. God, she gave everything. Do I consider the cost before I give? Do I consider the distance before I commit? God, do I consider it before I say yes? or am I 100% sold out to you? God, convict us this morning that we will be where you want us to be. Move. Move your people. And like last week, we talked about what the altar is for. It's to alter your mindset, to alter your behavior, to alter your response. If you need to come down to this altar and pray about anything, please come on. Don't let what somebody's going to think hold you back. You do what God called you to do this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. If you don't respond, please at least be in an attitude of prayer, praying, God, am I where you want me to be? If you do respond, you need somebody to pray with you, I'd be honored. Grab a brother or sister on the way down, but don't stay unchanged. Jesus knows. He's very perceptive. He knows where you're at. The question is, do we? Let's do business with God while it's still today. While the song plays, you respond. Father, thank you so much for meeting with us this morning. God, for speaking a word to our heart, Lord. God, we lift those up today that are grieving. Father, those that are sick. God, those that are hurting. Lord, those that are traveling. Father, those that are trying to find a direction for their life. God, I pray that you be all things that we need today. Lord, we thank you for those that were back with us this week. God, we thank you for everything that's going on behind the scenes, Lord. Father, we lift up our nation, our country, and our leaders. That God, they would turn their eyes back towards you. That we would be once again one nation under God, instead of one nation divided against God. Father, speak through the lives and the hearts of your people. That, Father, your word would not return void, as the prophet Isaiah promised. God, we love you. We pray as we go out these doors that we carry Jesus everywhere we go. In your name we pray, Father. Amen.